Do not be shaken. Do not be shaken. This is our fourth study now. We've been trying to go through it methodically as we've looked now to 2 Thessalonians, and we're most likely going to spend a couple weeks in 2 Thessalonians, and then very soon we'll be together in here for Resurrection Sunday. Very excited by that. Got some fun things in store, some traditional hymns that we'll be singing. That's a lot of fun things. So I encourage you to invite somebody. Come back, and it'll be a wonderful time of celebration for Resurrection Sunday. But we've got some things to cover here in 2 Thessalonians. And again, this is a tough one because the Apostle Paul, by the Holy Spirit, feels the need that right away into this second book is getting now into things that we have covered of the man of lawlessness, the rise and fall of the Antichrist. Not to give them more information. The intent here is not that they just simply learn a bunch of information for the sake of learning information, but rather to know how to discern the times in which they were in. We, the Western church, have been very pampered and even sheltered from adversity. But this is a church that was already going through such affliction, they already thought they were in the day of the Lord. Now, how discouraged might you feel if you read through everything we've already covered and felt like you were already at the end of Revelation 6 going, I thought we were supposed to be raptured by now. I thought all these things were supposed to be happening and we're supposed to go through all this and half the population's going to die and the seas are going to be stricken and the trees are going to be destroyed and the ships are all going to be crushed and there would be great fear, would there not? And that's not the attitude that we're to have here. In fact, if we understand then the right eschatological sequence of events, we're to have hope, great comfort in a peace that surpasses understanding. So this is all about how do we understand the day of the Lord and the comfort that comes when we have the truth. You see, the Apostle Paul is good about giving them the truth. Think about this. Here's a fledgling church. They're only but maybe a year old. The Apostle Paul, as you'll see here in a moment, he's going to say, do not forget the things that I already talked to you about. He had already talked to them about the end of days, about the apostasy, about the Antichrist. He was only with them for about 4, maybe 5 weeks. Could you imagine going out into your community, starting a brand new Bible study with a bunch of people who weren't even Christians? Getting them together, talking to them about Jesus, and immediately going right into eschatology. There are many churches that have been around for decades and haven't even covered eschatology. But he's already getting right to the point because it's the truth that gives us comfort. Not withholding the truth because we don't think that you're able to handle it. But by the Holy Spirit, when you receive the truth, you find comfort in that understanding. And you know that Paul has given them exactly the word of God and held nothing back. He's given them the meat. Can they handle it? By the Holy Spirit, they certainly can, and I believe we can as well. Now, as we talk about these things, I have my disclaimer here. I'm going to come at this from a dispensational pre-tribulation rapture perspective. That is not always the doctrine that many hold to. Some believe in a mid-trib, you know, where they're raptured out at the midpoint of the tribulation, or even a post-trib. And as you'll see as we go through some of this, it's tough to come to that conclusion for me. So I'm going to hold to what I know and what I've seen played out here scripturally that is clear as day to me. And I hope it is for you. But this is not an issue that should divide us. And what should unite us in this is the fact that if we have called on the name of the Lord, that we believe that he is our Savior, that he came in flesh, that's a key point, and that he died on the cross and rose again for us. If we believe this, then we're family. And these type of issues should not divide us. So you can hold to maybe a different perspective. And as you go and you study God's word, we should be able to have conversations about it. Because that's exactly what the enemy would love to do, is to say, that's what you believe. I don't believe that. I'm out of here. Well, let's talk about it. Let's spend some time together on this. I think that sometimes when we talk about a pre-tribulation rapture, some people get fearful that this might make one soft, might make the church soft, that we're only looking for our extraction instead of our mission-mindedness right now. I actually find that it's the reverse, that the extraction is part of the battle plan. If you're special forces or SEALs and you're going in with a God-honoring mission, The extraction's part of the deal. If he's throwing you in it and saying you're in the meat grinder and there's no way out, how are you going to feel about that? Are you going to be as bold as a lion as you ought to be? Or are you going to be more in a hunker down, let's wait this out type of thought process? See, I think that when the extraction plan is discussed, then you can be exactly as Christ wants you to be. Bold as a lion, shining brightly with the truth, giving the gospel message, even if it costs you everything, because you know that victory is on the horizon. You know that he's going to deliver you, his church. He has a plan. Even if you graduate today, i.e., that's my way of saying die, but I don't like that, because to the believer, 1 Corinthians 15 says, in the twinkling of an eye, faster than you can measure, faster than the speed of light, you are transformed into his presence. So you don't even have time to think about the fact that you just died. You're already there, right? So that's more like a graduation in an awesome way. So we call it a graduation. So you graduate from this flesh, you're with him, or you're raptured out of here, you're with him. There's no loss in this if you're with Jesus Christ, right? So that's the attitude. That's the hope that we have. But right now, we've got work to do. We are to be mission-minded soldiers of Jesus Christ. And when we have the right understanding about these things, we know that we will suffer persecution for the cause of Christ. Paul told young Timothy that in 2 Timothy 3:12, that all who desire to live a godly life in Christ will be persecuted. No ands, ifs, or maybes. You will, and you're probably going through some of it even now. Some of you, if you've taken a stand for Christ, maybe it caused you to lose a promotion. Maybe it caused friction in your family because the word of truth will bring like a sword a division even in homes. It's true. You're going to go through these battlefields, and it's to prepare you like boot camp for the next battlefield that you're going to experience. Not when. I mean, not if, but definitely when. So these are things that we have to learn. As we understand to put on the full armor of God, the Lord will allow hardships even the more we draw nearer to him. Did it ever feel like the closer you get to God, the more hardships come? Isn't that kind of discouraging at times? Where it's like, well, I'm praying more and I'm reading more and my thanks is more adversity. Why is that? I think it's because the Lord is not interested in rewarding you with more of the world, but with more of him. See, so often when we read Job and we skip to Job 42:10, where he was receiving double what he had before, we just skip right over 42 chapters of the Lord doing something more amazing than we could ever imagine, of going through the greatest adversity and the greatest triumph, and all we cared about is he got double back. No, he had a double relationship back. And the stuff, that was just to bring God glory for the temporary remainder of his years. It says he lived, I believe, it's 140 years thereafter, all to the glory of God. So the thing is, we have to realize is when we have a right focus here, we're not going to be so concerned about these temporary treasures of this earth, because we're focused on our mission, focused on our extraction, knowing we will be with the Lord possibly at any moment. That's imminency, the imminency. And that's why the Lord Jesus says twice, Matthew chapter 10 and 16, this is not in your notes, by the way, when he tells us, he who finds his life will lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake will find it. It's a total opposite of what you would expect. That the moment you draw near to the Lord and you keep drawing near to the Lord, it seems like the adversities amplify. It's because it's all against the flesh, and something glorious is happening when you sacrifice the temporary for the eternal. That's the right mission-mindedness of a soldier for Jesus Christ. We should expect trials and tribulations. I'm not talking about the tribulation. I'm talking about the tribulations we may go through before the tribulation. By that point, I believe we're out of here. But it doesn't mean that we won't go through adversity before that. I mean, try telling that to the 70 million Christians who have given their lives in service to the Lord. So there will be adversity before the time of the judgment, before the time of the wrath. But he has us here for a reason as a Christian soldier. I believe that's because we can then demonstrate as children of the light that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. That's what that's all about. That's why I love this particular verse. I put it on pink note this morning. 2 Corinthians 4:17. He puts it all in perspective there. Write that one down. Go back and read that. 2 Corinthians 4:17. These are but momentary afflictions. Momentary afflictions. Whatever you're going through, it's not the end game. It is but something momentary. And so whatever adversity you're going through, it is a temporary thing in the scope of eternity. We have to have an eternal mindset. That's why the Apostle Paul told Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:4, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. That's important to understand. That's the right paradigm. And that's what we're talking about here this morning. Knowing that the day of the Lord is coming, what will be your mindset? Running in fear or looking up with great victory and assuredness? Knowing that the Lord will hold to all of his promises and that he knows the very number of the hairs upon your head, and he will not leave you. He will not forsake you. He will be with you through and through, and he's eager to bring you home, to gather you unto himself. It doesn't please the Lord to afflict and destroy you and crush you. It pleases the Lord to crush sin. But it pleases the Lord in this to bring out something glorious unto himself. And I believe he desires, as the bridegroom desires to be with the bride, there's an eagerness to go and gather his bride unto himself. That's a beautiful thing. Let's read it together. You can turn with me to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. Here's what we're going to go through. All these 12 verses, and I'll try to bring it out to you without spending too much time on each verse, because we've spent a lot of time in this already. He says, now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all powers, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. So the Apostle Paul here gives us the pulse of the rise and fall of the Antichrist. The Apostle John would speak of many Antichrists that already had come in 1 John chapter 2, verse 18, saying that the final Antichrist will emerge. So even throughout all of time, we have seen those who have been against God and his people. You could start with Nimrod. You can even make your way all the way to Antiochus IV. History is wrought with these who sought to destroy the things of God, the people of God, and to blaspheme the holy name of God. So many antichrists have already been in the world, but this final antichrist is yet to come. His rise is currently being restrained by the Holy Spirit. And I believe after the rapture, then we see the first judgment. The seal judgments that are opened on the earth is the very first two verses of Revelation chapter 6. It is the releasing, the unleashing of this Antichrist upon the world. That's the very first judgment in Revelation chapter 6, 1 to 2 of the final Shemitah cycle, the final 7 years. So the first judgment is a wicked ruler. How interesting is that? Seems like we're very familiar with that in our time and age. And we see the impact of wicked rulers on society at large. Those who do not turn to the Word of God, those who do not heed the Word of God, nor the warnings of the Word of God, we see how it affects all of society. But in this case, what we're going to find here in a moment is society is then reflected by its leader. Jeremiah chapter 3 tells us that in verse 15. That if the hearts of the people were for the Lord, in repentance unto the Lord, he would give them shepherds who honored him. So the leadership would be a reflection of the heart of the people. So in this case, we find that this spirit of rebellion, this spirit of antagonistic mindset and efforts towards the things of God is not just reflected in its leadership, but in the hearts of the people themselves. He's empowered by Satan, the dragon, according to Revelation 13, verse 2. He will surpass all of Satan's agents, false prophets, and false teachers, possibly then the worst that has ever come. The earliest Christians knew that the time of the coming of the Lord, the day of the Lord, would be preceded by this global leader who would try to amass all power to himself and ultimately bring destruction to all who would follow him. He says here in verse 5, do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? You got to remember that at this point, they had been driven out of the city by an angry mob. So Paul is now writing these letters, putting them in the hands of Timothy to give to this fledgling church. And this will be important because Timothy will ultimately pastor in Ephesus. So he's running back and forth, giving the message. I don't know about literally running. Maybe he did. Elijah certainly ran everywhere. Maybe Timothy did too. I almost picture these guys with legs like this big around, you know, and they're like this big, but their legs are, I don't know. They probably ran everywhere, but they probably took horses too. So here's Timothy running back and forth with the letters of urgency from Paul to help clarify any misteachings, any false teachers that may be amongst them. They don't have 1 John and Revelation yet. These letters of 1 and 2 Thessalonians were probably written around 51 to 52 AD. Revelation wouldn't come about till possibly 95 to 96 AD. So we're talking about 45 years later before the revelation would be given. So how would they discern these things? Where would they go? Well, you might find it interesting that the Bible has a lot to say about a lot of matters. In fact, there are over 63,779 cross-references in the Bible. And what you'll find then through that is the Antichrist is mentioned 46 times, 33 of those in the Old Testament, 13 in the New. So they would have done like we did when we went through this study, was Daniel chapter 7 to 11, Ezekiel 21 to 28, Zechariah 11, and even the sermon that the Lord gave on the Mount of Olives, the Olivet Discourse of Matthew 24. So he speaks a lot about these things. So Apostle Paul would have taken, most likely, this fledgling church, taken them back to the Old Testament, showing them that this was never a surprise. It was always to be unveiled. This is what the Lord is going to do and allow as part of the judgments upon this earth. It almost seems out of character, though, that here's this young church, and you would take them immediately to eschatology. You would take them immediately to something like this. Why would you give them such a heavy message when they're just trying to figure out their stride right now? Well, it's because the Holy Spirit dictated it through Paul. And they needed the truth. He doesn't withhold the truth, and he's already reminding them of what they already knew to be the truth. I believe the reason for all of this, though, is to give them comfort. To talk about this rise of this Antichrist to give them comfort. You're like, well, how does that work? This is where you give me your best puzzled look. So we're talking about the Antichrist, and that's supposed to bring me comfort? I'm not following on that one yet. It'll come together. Let me show you this. By the end of everything he's taught here, listen to what he says in just chapter 2, verses 16 to 17. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and our God and Father who has loved us and given us everlasting consolation and good hope by grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. That's what he wants them to leave with. We're going to talk about the Antichrist, the rise and fall of him, and this godless society, but at the end of this, you're supposed to leave comforted. You'll see how that happens here in a moment. Paul had already prefaced this content with the hope-giving message of the rapture. That was 1 Thessalonians 4, 13, 18. We went through that. He concluded that teaching with, therefore comfort one another with these words. You heard about the rapture? Comfort each other. We love talking about that, right? That's an easy one to be comforted by. Antichrist, comforted. Not sure how that one fits. Well, listen to what he said next. In the chronological sequence, he then taught in 1 Thessalonians 5 about the day of the Lord, and listen to how he ended that one. Therefore, comfort each other. So we've talked about the rapture, comfort each other. Talked about the day of the Lord, comfort each other. Now we're talking about the rise of the Antichrist and the fall of the Antichrist, comfort each other. Seems like he's got a pretty consistent theme in that. Why comfort each other? Because the truth brings comfort. We know the truth. And it seems so elusive today. That somewhere, even right now in churches around America, there may be such a diluting of the message, you are going to try to have a hard time pulling out whatever slices might actually be truth in there. The rest of it might just sound like the wisdom of men, and we know how truth that is. So it's going to be ever elusive then in this culture to find the truth, and here's Paul just giving him, the truth will bring you comfort. The truth of God's word, here it is. In 1 Thessalonians 5:4, he then reminds them that they are true Christians who are not in the darkness and will not be overtaken by the day of the Lord because they're not appointed to wrath. That's the key. Revelation 6 and the judgments of the seals says it's the day of the wrath of God. Revelation 14 says it again. So the beginning of the final 7 years begins with the wrath of God. The end of the final 7 years ends with the wrath of God being poured out in the final bowl judgments. It is a time of the wrath of God being poured out. But you, brothers and sisters, are not appointed unto wrath. Does that not give you some confidence, some comfort? It may feel at times like the persecution is heavy, but you are not in the time of the wrath. I take great comfort in knowing the fact that even when Israel was in Egypt, they were preserved by the hand of God in Goshen when all of the plagues came upon Egypt. They had plenty of daylight over their houses while darkness covered the rest of Egypt. While their water was turning into blood, Israel's water was perfectly fine. How is that possible? That but a few miles apart, somebody could be in such darkness they can't even see their own hand, and on the other side of the river, there suddenly is perfect daylight. God preserved them as he plans to preserve you. That is the comfort that we have in this. That God will come for his own. Jesus Christ, the bridegroom, will come for his bride. He will deliver us. Therefore, we do not need to fear the day of the Lord. The Apostle Paul began 2 Thessalonians with affirming this church that the afflictions that they were suffering were not in vain. And God would repay against all of those who were bringing affliction upon them with his holy justice, his holy vengeance. So those who are faithful ought then to be comforted. This is all about relief. God knows your suffering. He knows the trials you're going through. But this is all part of his plan, and he will deliver you. You will not go through the wrath of God. That's such comfort. So this is so we don't get shaken. This is about your composure. I can almost imagine some of you who have been drill sergeants trying to put young recruits and whatnot through the regimen of getting them ready for when actual bombs start to fall, when actual bullets start to whiz over their heads, getting them used to the sound, getting them used to the familiar of their environment being disrupted and keeping their composure. And that's what Paul is doing as our commanding officer, if you will, under the lordship of Jesus Christ, to walk through our ranks and get us ready that when you're going through adversity, this is not the wrath of God. This is the appointment that the Lord has prepared for you because through it, all sin is going to be purged. He is going to sanctify. He's going to do a good and mighty work through you to bring himself glory. Do you trust him? We got to get shaken sometimes. I find it interesting that when missionaries pray for us, have you ever heard that? Yeah, Jim Daly at Focus on the Family shared stories like that too when we were in staff there. He would talk to us about that, how missionaries were praying for the church in America because we'd gotten so weak. As soon as we stub our toe, oh, the affliction, you know, and then you talk to a believer in Iran, it's like, well, I just lost 3 family members this week for being a Christian, and you're complaining about your stubbed toe? What we do know is a fact that we will be delivered from the wrath of God. That's a fact. But we have to be toughened up to endure, to understand that affliction does not mean that God is absent from your presence. There's a great and mighty work that he is doing. Listen to how he starts this. Verse 1. Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and gathering together to him. What does that sound like to you? See, we want a nice little fancy title, rapture. We want, you know, harpazo to be right there. We want rapimur to be there. But in reality, that's exactly what he's describing. Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him. You see, when the Lord Jesus comes back at Armageddon and brings down the Antichrist and destroys the armies that are against him, we've already been in heaven and coming back with him on white horses. So to gather us, he's got to do that before then. And that's where the wedding feast with the Lamb happens. That's where you've received a new body suitable to do service on the earth once again for the whole millennial kingdom. So this can't be at the moment. He's not going to up, grab your horse, right back down. Oh, there's something we're missing in the timeline. And then I think that's where the 7 years of a beautiful 7-day wedding feast correlates so perfectly. He's going to gather us to himself. That's part of the Greek syntax here of this one article, which means there are two expressions. It means there is a thematic thread running through this about the rapture. He wants them to take hope in these things. You could almost paraphrase it by saying, we've talked about the coming of the Lord and the rapture, the glorious hope that's before us. Now it's time to keep your composure as we talk about the end of days. How then will you conduct yourself? Verse 2, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. The persecution was already so intense, according to chapter 1, verse 4, that they felt like they were already in the day of the Lord. Sometimes we can look at the circumstances around us in the world today and feel like, well, we've got to be getting pretty close to Revelation chapter 6 and the second seal, right? Does it feel like that? But we got to know the Word. And by the word, we can discern the events that are going on around us, not by the opinions of men, but by taking it back to the roadmap, back to the legend of how to interpret the signs of the times, lest we be deceived, lest we interpret things wrongly. They're growing fearful. They're shaken. Their confidence is being lost. Some may have been even losing hope. And to top things off, there was a catalyst in here of a letter that had been falsified from Paul circulating in their midst, already telling them that they were in the day of the Lord. That's why he says, by word or by letter, as if from us. We didn't say those things. We didn't tell you that you were in the day of the Lord. We'd already talked about this, that the day of the Lord is still forthcoming. You're not in it now with your present adversity. Now think about this. We're talking about around 51 to 52. All of you history buffs will know that they're under Claudius, the Roman emperor, at this point. Who's the next emperor that comes after Claudius? Nero. At around 17 years of age, he takes the throne, and he's a narcissist of narcissists. In fact, he used to call himself Lord of Glory. Wanted all this attention. I mean, what do we expect when you put a teenager in power over the entire known world and just give him limitless power and he brings it all to himself? I mean, anyway, you can only imagine how messed up this was. He decides to start persecuting the Christians. From 54 to 313 AD, 45,000 Christians will be slaughtered under 8 different emperors, all the way to Diocletian. And so they haven't even gotten there yet. If they can't discern the signs of the times of where they're at right now, how are they going to possibly endure when Nero comes to power? So you may think it's bad now, but you haven't even started yet. You got to get your composure now. You can't be so easily shaken when things aren't going your way now. It's going to get tougher, but the Lord will be with you. The Lord will strengthen you. He has not forgotten you. You belong to him, and he will be right there with you, just as he was with Daniel in the lion's den, just as he was with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fire, dancing in the fire. He will be with you. He will carry you through, and there is a glorious hope that awaits. So even today, we find that conspiracy theories, many just call them theories, can cause many to lose their peace and take their eyes off the prize. They get stirred up, and rightfully so, when you read the news long enough, when you hear all the theories of men, and it can just rob you of joy. But yet our insatiable curiosity, we can't stop. We'll watch it again tomorrow. We'll listen to it again the next day. We can't get enough. It's the water cooler talk of we've figured out who the Antichrist is, and we've figured out Satan's next move. Ha! Great! What are you going to do with that? I don't know, but I figured it out. Right? It's like, what's the end goal with all of this? Because all you've done is robbed yourself of the joy and the peace of knowing the Lord. See, if you don't have a prayer life like we talked about last week, you will be easily shaken. If you don't have a prayer life like we talked about last week, you will have too tight of a grip on this world. You will put roots too deep. Your identity will be in your nest, your house, your cars, your familiarity, your creature comforts. All these things give you peace of mind, and it ought not to be. You should be willing to let all of that go. Your peace of mind is right here in God's holy word. So the closer you draw to him, the less concerned you'll be with all of that stuff. It all breaks anyway. Why is it that things always break down when you don't have money? You get an amen on that one? That's like all the time, right? I mean, just when you have the paycheck to cover things, nothing happens. The moment you spend it, and then the water heater breaks, the transmission goes out. And it's like, why didn't that happen a week ago? It's just to remind you, you're not there yet. This is not heaven. This is all temporary stuff that is simply a means to an end. It's just to accomplish your goals with, the goals that ought to be his goals, his agenda being your agenda, right? We talked about that last week. So I find it fitting in Isaiah chapter 8, verses 12 to 13. He says, do not say a conspiracy concerning all that this people call a conspiracy, nor be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. The Lord of hosts, him you shall hallow. Let him be your fear. Rather than giving so much time to Fox News, turn to the Word of God. In the midst of chaos, you will find an ever-present hope. You will find a sure foundation, a strength in the midst of the winds and the turbulent times in which we are in. You will not find that in media. You will find that in God's holy Word. That's where we ought to turn. So, we're to be comforted, not shaken. The true church does not need to fear the day of the Lord. Look what he says, verses 2 to 3. Read it again. Not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means. Let no one deceive you. He drew that, I believe, from the Olivet Discourse. Matthew 24:4, the Lord Jesus himself says, take heed that no one deceives you. That's how he began that whole sermon. Jesus' final sermon begins with that. Take heed that no one deceives you. That means the truth is clear. We've made it cloudy. We've put eisegesis into his word instead of proper exegesis. What does it say? Navigate life by what it says. Don't try to justify sin. Don't try to cloud it for your own objectives. What does it say? We've made it difficult to understand. So he says, let no one deceive you. Why? Well, because we know what the angels will do, and those who have fallen, the fallen angels, will disguise themselves. Satan himself disguised himself. He says here in 2 Corinthians 11:14 that Satan will disguise himself as an angel of light, and even those who serve him will disguise themselves as ministers of righteousness, according to 2 Corinthians 11:15. So we know that deceivers will be amongst us, and they will attempt to confuse. 2 John 1:7 says that. So take heed that no one deceives you, because at the root of it all is Satan himself. He says that Satan is a deceiver, Revelation 12:9, and the father of lies, according to John 8:44. So believers can find themselves chasing all the latest end-time theories rather than testing everything by the Word of God, the lens of it all. So if we don't know the Word, We're going to be easily drawn astray into all sorts of false doctrine. He tells Timothy that in 2 Timothy 4, 3-4, that people will not endure sound doctrine, turning from truth to fables. So they're still going to appear religious, but they don't want the truth. They're going to be taken over by something else, something that is craving, something that satisfies the flesh. Peter said, "What manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God? When you know the truth and the truth has set you free, you will live with this truth before you. Not some man-made attempt to make you not worried, not thinking about things, living your best life now, all those sort of things, all the lies and illusion that are perpetuated on the human mind, but rather we will know the truth and walk in that truth. He will deliver us from the wrath to come. Do not be easily led astray." Listen to what he says next, verses 3 to 5. "Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first. And the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? Do not forget. Remember what I told you. When you pick up the news, when you hear of adversities, when you hear of these things that are causing the flesh to be concerned or scared, do not be dismayed. Do not give in to a shaken, fearful spirit." He had already told them about the rapture, already talked to them about the day of the Lord, the coming judgment, the apostasy, even the man of lawlessness. And we see here he doesn't give a lot of details about any of that. He just rolls right through it as if they should already know it. Now, there are 46 verses, after all. So they should know these things, but they have to be reminded of what they already know. Paul just rolls right through this because I believe they probably studied the book of Daniel as we did. But in the sequence of things, it's interesting that this is such a prophetic marker. If the Antichrist rising to broker peace with Israel is the first indicator that we are in the final 7 years, then it would be interesting to know that if this is this thing called the apostasia must precede that. That's a huge prophetic marker then. So as you're looking at your timeline here and you go, okay, so if we're in the final 7 years, not we now, but at some point in the near future, there's going to be a final 7 years, then there's something that comes up before that called the apostasia. What is that? It would be helpful to know what that is so we would know this marker that's supposed to happen before the Antichrist comes on the scene. Well, let's find out. 2 Thessalonians 2:3 says the word apostasia that is often used from the Strong's Greek 646, meaning falling away or even to forsake, as we see in Acts 21:21. We also take into account that the verb form of this word is aphistemi, which is used for departing a room or leaving a room. It's used in 16 other places. So the older text before 1611 King James Version used the word departure rather than falling away. So something happens before the Antichrist comes on the scene to broker peace with Israel that he'll break 3.5 years in. It's called the apostasia, and it has sort of a dual meaning here, to fall away or to depart from something. Are you following? So what is that? Who's departing, and from where are they departing? That might be good to know so that we understand this marker. Now, I want you to keep this in mind. If you're an agrarian society, and you have maybe worked some fields at some point in your life, when we say it's harvest, one word, what would that mean to you? There's a lot of work that's going into harvest. We say one word, but there's a lot more to it than just the one word. Harvesting means you're taking what is good and you're expunging and purging that which is bad. In Matthew chapter 13, the Lord gave us an image of this. Remember that? Wheat with the tares. You've got the weeds alongside that which is desirable, They're both growing up side by side. The tares look just like the wheat, but it comes time for harvest, you have to pull one away from the other. There's two actions that are happening in one event. When you harvest fish in the Sea of Galilee and they would drag a net, Matthew 13, the Lord ends with another parable about that, the drag net. They would drag all the fish in, they would go through the fish, and they would keep the fish that were desirable and discard the fish that were not, sometimes casting them right back into the waters. So if you've ever been to the Sea of Galilee, you'll know the story of the 153 fish, and you understand that there are a lot of fish that are desirable and a lot of fish that are not. Tilapia being St. Peter's fish, right? That's the one that you would want to keep, and you would discard the carp or the catfish. So in they go, perhaps back into the water. They're an undesirable fish. So in this particular case, you've got to understand there's something bigger going on here than may meet the eye initially. One word, apostasia, could mean a lot of things happening, at least two major events at the same time. Paul wrote to Timothy, stating in 1 Timothy 4:1, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons." That would never happen, would it? That they would be in the church, leave the truth, and go for something else, maybe even to what looks like another church, appearing very religious, but not with the truth. He says that they'll appear religious, appear godly, but they will deny the truth, according to 2 Timothy chapter 3, and not endure sound doctrine, according to 2 Timothy 4. This is why the Lord punishes them with, as we just read in 2 Thessalonians, a strong delusion that they should believe the lie, and that they may all be consumed who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. He says that because the Apostle Paul already addresses this later on in Romans chapter 1, that when people love the darkness rather than the light, he turns them over in Romans 1, 24 to uncleanness, to vile passions in verse 26, and to a debased mind in verse 28. When they love the darkness, the things of darkness more, he allows them to walk in that blindness. When you have tasted the truth and you know the truth, but you reject the truth, then part of the judgment is to give your dark mind exactly what the dark mind wants. He says in Hebrews chapter 6, verses 4 to 6, that there will be those who are exposed to the truth, have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come, and they will still reject the truth and blaspheme the Holy Spirit. This is described as crucifying the Son of God again and putting Jesus to open shame, according to Hebrews 6:6. Only a few chapters later in Hebrews 10, he then goes on to add, "Of how much worse punishment do you suppose will he be thought worthy who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, counted the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified a common thing, and insulted the Spirit of grace?" This text makes clear to us what is already said in Matthew 13 when Jesus gave that parable of the wheat and the tares growing up side by side. The tares reject the truth. They look like Christians, maybe, even sound like them, but they love the religiosity and not Jesus Christ. They will be added then to Matthew 7, 21 to 23 when he says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, 'Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.'" You see, that's the epitome of the age. It'll be a time of lawlessness in the hearts of men, desiring anything and everything the flesh wants, and then having a leader who does likewise. Before the tribulation, I believe there will be a separation of people. There will be a harvest, as the rapture will bring. The wheat will be gathered into his barn, but the tares will be bound and must face the judgment. We see that in Matthew 13:30. It would be like dragging the net in, pulling the fish in that you want to keep and discarding the rest back into the waters. They must face the wrath of God. At the end, there'll be a separation called the goats from the sheep, according to Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. So again, we come back to the question, who is departing and from where are they departing? Is it possible that we're seeing two events in that? When it's harvest time, one is taken, the other is purged. There are two actions in one event. This is perhaps why the word apostasia is such a difficult word to fully grasp in the English, because just like the word love is very difficult to grasp in the English, I can say I love pizza and love my wife, and it is not the same. There are seven different words in the Greek to try to describe then what love means. The English uses one. And then we try to fill in the blanks with everything that we love. I love the weather outside. I love this carpet. I love my wife. I love my children. Love that chair. Not the same. And so what we have here in the Greek is a word that is describing something big. There's a departure of one possibly from the earth while there's a falling away of a group from the truth. And then they must go through the wrath of God under the leadership of the lawlessness they represent. It's a powerful thing. Revelation describes this wicked ruler who embodies the spirit of a rebellion. He is called the son of perdition. Judas was called the son of perdition. He was a betrayer. The Antichrist will be a betrayer. He will betray the people of Israel when he establishes a 7-year covenant treaty with them and breaks it halfway in. He will turn on people groups and nations, according to Revelation 6. He will ultimately turn against God himself when he declares himself to be God. And so apostasia also declares revolt or rebellion of a people who are rebelling against the heart of God. Revelation says that 7 times... the people will have an opportunity to repent, and they will not repent. It even says in Revelation chapter 6 at the end, they will know that they're under the hand of God in his wrath, and they will flee to the caves instead of turning to repentance before the holy God. That's what we do, don't we? When you're in sin, you run and flee back into more sin. But if you're of the light, you go into the light, and you are restored. There's grace that abounds in the light. So the children of the light know exactly where to go when they have broken the heart of God. They go right back into the light, not fleeing into the darkness. The time of the end will be marked by lawlessness and led by a man of lawlessness. But here's the hope. You ready for some hope? I find it very fitting of the heart of God, who, like the thief on the cross, who at the moment of his execution, there was still hope. As long as there was breath in his body, that he could confess who Jesus Christ was, there was the assurance of salvation, that he would be in paradise with the Lord. Sometimes, though, we cling to that and just say, well, right up to the very end, you have an opportunity so you can kind of live it up now. No man knows the day or the hour that they will meet with the Lord, nor do we know the day or the hour in which all things will come. Like a thief in the night, it will come. You have to be prepared today. So here's the glorious hope, that unless they take the mark of the beast, even the fish, the catfish, the carp that were thrown back into the waters can become tilapia. The tares that were discarded and thrown aside can still become wheat. You and I were once tares, and we became wheat. So the heart of our God, that even under the 7 years of the greatest tribulation that people will ever face on the face of the earth, there is still hope. The clarion call continues to go out with 144,000 witnesses, 2 witnesses in Jerusalem, and then listen to what an angel of the Lord declares. Revelation 14, 6 to 7. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, "Fear God and give glory to him. For the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and springs of water." And there'll be a great multitude. A huge harvest will come in, even during the final 7 years. Can you imagine a catfish turning into a tilapia? What an image that is. Or the weed that was discarded becoming the wheat in the barn of our Lord. And that's what can happen. Only the Lord can do that. That's his mercy on display, because 2 Peter 3:9 says that he desires that none should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And 2 Thessalonians 2:4 then says, as the Apostle Paul brings their attention to this act of defiance, that here the great betrayer will rule for 1,260 days. That's it. 3.5 years. So while there's a final 7-year period of time and his rise to power continues, at the point where he declares himself to be God, the abomination of desolation occurs, and then he turns his attention to the whole world to conquer for 3.5 years. 2/3 of Israel are slain. Those, as he goes out, who do not confess him as a God on earth are also slain. He'll force those to have the mark of the beast. If they do not take it, they also are slain, all to bring power to himself. And he will sell his soul to the devil ultimately for all eternity so that he can rule for 3.5 years. His victory is temporary, very temporary. He will be destroyed. Verse 8 says, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. Wow! That's the Shekinah glory of Jesus Christ being made manifest right before them. In Zechariah, it says that men will dissolve where they stand with the brightness of the glory of the Lord before them. And here the enemy of our souls, Satan, will be bound and thrown into the abyss for 1,000 years. The Antichrist and the false prophet are sent into the lake of fire where they will remain for the rest of eternity. All because they brought persecution even to the people of God in Israel, to the Christians, to those who would not take his mark. It will not be a time of good pleasures. It'll be a time of absolute conviction. You will have to know, those who remained for the tribulation will have to know what they believe and why. And for us who are before the tribulation, likewise, we must know what we believe and why. But for us, we have this blessed hope before us that the church will be drawn to himself before these final 7 years. That's why it's called our blessed hope. In John chapter 14, he says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. The bride of Christ is very special to the groom. He has gone off to prepare a place for us, and he will draw us to himself. And for that, we will spend 7 years in glory and then come back with him on white horses to watch our Lord reign on high. It's going to be an awesome and spectacular sight. That's why in Titus 2, we call it the blessed hope. Listen to what he says. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, we're looking for Jesus Christ, not the Antichrist. So when you keep turning to the news, wondering if this is the day, if this is the hour, and trying to outsmart the enemy, we need to be spending our time knowing our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This will give you the confidence that you need, the strength that you need to endure all afflictions that may come even before the rapture occurs. Because the Lord needs to find us doing his work, occupying until he comes. And that's why the Apostle Paul will spend some of the rest of 2 Thessalonians talking about this, where some had just stopped work altogether, thinking the rapture is going to be here any moment. I don't need to even go to work tomorrow. People wouldn't think like that, right? And here he's saying, no, you've got work to do. We've got to delay the decay of the day by being in the way. I love that one. Matt Maher came up with that one. So we got to be comforted, be encouraged, be strong. Do not give in to fear. If you're running in fear, then your faith has no value to a lost world. When you keep looking up and your strength is in Jesus Christ, you will be a magnet to the lost who are looking for hope, looking for assurance, looking for strength in the middle of turbulent times. We must not be shaken. You are children of the light, not of the darkness. He has a plan for you. He will come for you. Let me remind you again of this powerful word, 1 Thessalonians 4:16 to 18. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with a trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then those who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. We can know about the Antichrist, his rise and his fall, as temporary as it will be, but it should not consume us. It's important to know so we're not discouraged by what we face today, and to know that the Lord has a plan. He will come for you, he will deliver, and he will work through you even now to bring himself glory. Are you assured of that? That's the comfort. That's the comfort. That's what we're to draw away from this. You don't focus on the Antichrist, you focus on Jesus Christ, who's the author and perfecter of your faith. Do not be discouraged, brothers and sisters. Do not be shaken. Do not be fearful. The Lord has a plan even in this. Do you believe it? As we close in prayer, Sheldon and Kimberly Valaire are going to be our prayer team this morning. If you have somebody you would like to pray for, somebody who's going through some affliction right now and you want to seek the Lord for some help, some guidance in their life, some strength, even perhaps for a decision you have. If you would also perhaps leave a prayer request on your bulletin, that little detachable piece, leave that for us. We'll be praying for those on Wednesday. But before you leave here today, please pray with Brother Sheldon and Miss Kimberly. They would love to pray with you for whatever things you're going through right now. Let's close in prayer. We'll sing together. Heavenly Father, thank you so very much for the study of your word. As difficult as it is at times to read, eschatology can be exhausting. But I pray, Father, that we not allow this word to discourage us, but rather to encourage us, that the truth is before us, that you have already revealed your plans, and that you have a plan for us. I praise you, Father, that you will always strengthen us. You will always encourage us by and through your word. May we be a people of prayer, not considering whether we pray today, but how often we pray today, and how often we'll be on our knees before you and finding strength in our time of need. I pray, Father, that time of need is every day for us, that we need you for our next breath. We need you for everything. I pray you would fill every part of our lives, that we not just try to add you to the mix, but that you would consume us, that we would be fully consumed by you, and we'd live for you, breathe for you. Father, I pray that this joy would overflow us and exude from our very countenance, that those who would see would run to you. May we be filled with truth, the people of truth, and eager to speak that truth. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Is beautiful, and your eyes are like the stars. Your gentle hands have healing there inside the scars. Your loving arms, they draw me near, and your smile, it brings me peace. Draw me closer, oh my Lord. Draw me closer, Lord, to Thee. And captivate us, Lord Jesus. Set our eyes on You. Devastate us with Your presence falling down. And a rushing river, draw nearer. And consume us with You, and captivate us, Lord Jesus, with You. Your voice is powerful, and Your words are radiant bright. In Your breath and shadow I will come close and abide. You whisper love and life divine, and your fellowship is free. Draw me closer, oh my Lord, draw me closer, Lord, to Thee. Captivate us, Lord Jesus. Set our eyes on You. Devastate us with Your presence falling down. In a rushing river, draw nearer. Holy fountain, consume us with You. Captivate us, Lord Jesus, with You. And let everything be lost in the shadows of the light of Your face. Let every chain be broken from me as I'm bound in Your grace. For Your yoke is easy, Your burden is light, You're full of wisdom, power, and might, and every eye will see You. Captivate us, Lord Jesus, set our eyes on You, devastate us with Your presence falling down. In a rushing river, draw nearer. Holy fountain, consume us with You. And captivate us, Lord Jesus, with You. Captivate us, Lord Jesus, with You. Captivate us. Dear Heavenly Father, God, You are so worthy to be praised. You sit on high over the universe, God, and You love us, each individual one of us, God. And I just am in awe. I'm in awe of who You are and that You would choose me. We are not worthy, God, and I just ask that You would just continue to draw us to You, Lord, that we would not be able to go through our day without thinking of You, God, without praying with You, without speaking with You, without walking with You, God, that You would be in the midst of all that we do. I thank You, God, for Your glory, God, for Your grace, for Your mercy. And I pray that the people who are in this place today, God, would be blessed by this message, and that those that are around them would also be blessed, because Your light goes out far beyond what we could ever imagine. God, we love You. We are in awe of who You are, and You are worthy to be praised. And it is in Your holy, precious name we pray. Amen.